am Charmelle McMillan, and this is the second episode of season two. It is what it is, how men think, where men talk about love, life, relationships, and everything in between. Tell it like it is. A little bit of history. About 10 years ago, I created and produced a radio show called It Is What It Is, The Male Perspective on Life and Relationships. And I did so because at the onset of social media, sometimes questions will be asked exclusively to men, and inevitably women would be the first ones to chime in. And they wouldn't just chime in. They would say, they would edit, correct, even tell men, that ain't how men think. So I decided to create a platform where men tell it like it is, uncut. And so with that being said, skip ahead to 2020. I recreated it as a Zoom show. And so that's what we're doing tonight. This is not a woman bashing platform. It's definitely not a male bashing platform. It just is what it is. Every Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 5 p.m. Pacific. So tune in and join us weekly. With that being said, let me introduce my guest tonight. My first guest, he is the co-host of With All Due Offense podcast. I have seen him numerous times on tour with one of his best friends. He is absolutely hilarious. And I know he won't mind me saying this, but I was like 4 days ago, years old, when I realized he was Black. So, but he is absolutely hilarious. He hails out of Naptown and Austin Hall.
Thank you. Start the video. There you go. Look, they even believe you even more now. This, oh no, we still don't believe you Black.
I was like, he is the coolest white boy ever. It's like he be knowing.
I love the setup you got, Charmelle. Though I do.
Thank you so much. So let me introduce my next guest. I met him in Hollywood a few years ago. And he just had this vibe that I felt like I needed to go introduce myself. Before I get over to him, he turned around and said hello. He was wearing a bathrobe in the Laugh Factory. He looked like he was running stuff, though, so I didn't know if I was overdressed or underdressed, but I wanted to know the man in the bathrobe. And so beyond that, he is a comedian, actor, host, television, and radio personality, promoter extraordinaire, and he is Black and Persian. And so we got the international show going on today. He speaks several languages. He hails from my hometown, Washington, D.C., my friend, TEHRAN von GHASRI.
I just want to say I appreciate you, Charmelle, bringing someone who's even lighter skinned than me on the show. Smart. Way to go. That's what I'm talking about.
I knew it was coming.
My DM started popping when I put the flyer up. They were like, wait a minute, what's going on here? They want to know more about you, Tara.
I'm in there.
Like, he's cute.
I'll take it.
So they're like, he's like Drake without all the drama. That's what I heard. So so anyway, my last guest is, he's something like a phenomenon. I met him several years ago, and he headlines clubs, sold out clubs all over the country. He is super talented. He never disappoints, and he is clever, witty, and funny as hell. And one of the things I really respect about him is his process, not only his genius, but how he has developed his career and allowed himself to expand so that he gives his all to his audiences constantly, not just hundreds of millions of followers across the country. He hails from Concord, North Carolina, my friend, Dan Davis.
Hey, what up?
How are you? So tell me about the With All Due Offense podcast that you and Austin co-host.
Oh my gosh, listen. It is, I'm gonna be honest, man. I think we got the best podcast on the planet, man. It is, at first, I didn't know how it was going to turn out or anything like that. You know, no one ever really knows, but it ended up being the best decision I made this year, to be honest with you. You wonder, oh, is what I'm doing even entertaining? Is it?
Yeah.
It's fun because it's fun while we're doing it. Is it great to listen to? And I went back and listened to it, and I'm like, oh, I'm a fan of this show. It just happens to be my show. So, nah, man, if y'all ever want to check it out, go to With All Due Offense on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And if you like what you see a little bit there, you can catch the whole thing. It's on Patreon under 301 Studios.
Make sure to go and follow that, because I follow it. I follow it on Instagram. I follow it on Patreon. Unlike Ryan Davis, who does not follow me on Clubhouse. So you know how that goes. You know, you already know. What's up, Ryan?
I follow you around the Laugh Factory trying to get stage time. Does that help?
It's not the same, Ryan Davis. It's not the same. Ryan and I are in hella Clubhouse rooms, and he doesn't follow me. This hurt my heart. When I found out, I hurt my heart.
I'm gonna say something right now that's not going to that people aren't going to believe.
Austin's but I mean black.
It. But I mean it.
That's what I'm like.
I'm not really good at the social media stuff, so sometimes I don't know.
With 1.4 million followers on Facebook alone. Okay, I know what you mean. You know, I know what you mean.
I don't really know what I've been doing, yo. I was under the impression that I was following everybody.
You don't follow me either. But you know what? I know what soothed my soul about it. I mean, you follow me on IG now, but because I told you, I was like, hey, Ryan, what's going on?
I had to go
pick up my eye. I had to go. I rolled my eyes so hard. I had to go pick up.
When he said, Ryan, I'm not good at social media.
Followers. A million followers on every platform. You know who Ryan is? Ryan,
this is where we keep it real. This is where we keep it real, Ryan.
Y'all think I'm not keeping it real?
Ryan's the dude that balls in a shot going. He's like, oh, I'm not even trying. I don't even know how to play.
So, TEHRAN, you know what soothes my soul before we get started with all my friends not following me and I got 2,000 people in my phone? I talked to them on the phone. I was like, if I can call them direct, why am I tripping off of social media? So
yeah, that's actually
that
stupid.
Part.
And let me explain why. Because your friends should be following you first. It's support. Support amongst your friends. And on top of that, it's also a part of the support hierarchy of clout. And that's how it works. It's how you get friends. That's one thing I like about one of my favorite people, Tiffany Haddish, is when she made it to the top, she sent the elevator back down, but she didn't just send it back down. She came down in the elevator, grabbed you by the hand, and then took you up with her. That's right. The kind of stuff I like. That's who I thought Ryan Davis was. That's who I thought Ryan Davis, the kind of character that I know of Ryan Davis, because I know Austin. I know Austin very well. He's a good dude. He's got a good heart.
He's super funny too.
Exactly. Does he talk more black because he wants us to know he's black? Yes, he does. But I've seen him code switch out. I get it. I understand.
Hey, I ain't even gonna lie to you.
Ryan does not code switch. That's why.
I'm gonna tell you guys. I got the elevator, went down, grabbed TEHRAN, brought him up to my floor. He was like, "This is the highest floor you've been on."
I know. That's right. That's his vibe.
then he
I thought you was going up to the penthouse. You know what? Like, you go back
don't let TEHRAN fool y'all, nigga. He is further than me. Like, nigga.
Ryan is that dude. Austin's that dude. I've been in plenty rooms where their names get kicked around. And I'll tell you when you knew Ryan was that dude. Ryan and I went to an insecure party, not because we're insecure people. Issa Rae's insecure TV show party, and Issa Rae talking to me turns to Ryan and goes, and Ryan's like, "Hey, Issa," and she goes, "I know exactly who you are. I love your stuff." And then went through a list of stuff he'd done. When I say ended the conversation with me, shifted to Ryan. And then it was the Ryan show, and she was going through Ryan's opinions on things, like Ryan's literal opinions.
That's okay? Yo,
and I love even... Issa Rae, man. Shout out to Issa. In my defense, that's another one of those. Well, I didn't know. I didn't know she knew who I was.
See? And I wasn't, and listen, Charmel, can I please explain? I wasn't even trying to network. I was shooting my shot, like on the low.
Okay. You can do the layup.
I had a young lady where I was like, yo, I'm sorry. If Issa says yes, that is what's best. And I was like,
that's God's will.
I was sitting there so nervous. I was like, I don't know how I'm going to speak to her. Like, should I go, hey, should I reach for the hand? Should I come in for the hug? I mean, I did work on the show this season. What do we do? I was like, so hey, and then like Teron said, she was just like, oh, nigga, no, oh man, we were cracking up about your stuff. Well,
I was like, oh. They had inside jokes, Charmel. They had inside jokes. He just now, met her.
Teron, you know what? I'm gonna do like black people do, and what soothes my soul, I will be viral if all my friends followed me. Just that's the celebrities I've helped over 25 years. Just the celebrities I've helped, if they followed me.
That's one thing that does bother me. Is like, we have enough power to where if all of us supported like one friend at a time, that person would blow immediately. We could do that every week, technically, if we wanted to. We really
if you wanted to.
If you wanted to.
You know what I tell myself?
Well, I do it. I do it, but I stand alone. I be making all these lists. I be doing all this promotion of other people. And everybody just goes, that's some cool stuff you doing, Ryan. I'm like, do it with me. Repost my list.
This is how I soothe my soul before we get started. This is how I soothe myself. I was like, how most black people, God's got it. God knows.
Yeah.
I just leave it to God. I was like, God's got it. He gonna take care of it.
let me that sounds great, Charmel. If that was the case, there wouldn't be homelessness or slavery. Let me explain something too. Ryan Davis made a list of like best comedian basketball players. Okay. And somehow he left me off the list to the point where people actually wrote in the comments, how did you leave TEHRAN off the list?
I've never seen TEHRAN play basketball. Had no idea he played basketball.
I saw that comment too. It was from TEHRAN.
It was not TEHRAN.
It was like, yo, how you leave me off the list?
I wrote afterwards because I wasn't even aware of the list. And I'll tell you something, to the point you were making before, Ryan is right. It's interesting that we don't realize that comedy, entertainment, and in general life is a team sport. We can all do this together. We're all in the squad. Ryan and Austin are really like a team, and we see how they move, and it's great.
Right.
Because when you're walking at night, and it's a lot of times in comedy especially, people think it's a zero-sum game. I can only win if you lose, and it's not like that. There's a lane for all of us. And exactly. If you're walking at night and you look up in the sky and there's one or two stars, you might not ever look up again because it's nothing to look at. But it's when you walk at night and it's a sky full of stars, that's when you look up in awe. And that's what Hollywood and comedy could be if we all work together. So that's why, even though Ryan does not follow me on Clubhouse, I always give him and show him love. Because I know he follows me in his heart. And that, to me, is even more important.
I try to hang out when they're doing the podcast just so they notice they're not following me. They'd be like, hey, Char. They'd be like, hey, Char.
Yo, this is really got tears coming out of my eyes.
When they see this recording, they're going to be like, yo, we gonna hire him for some more stuff. We ain't even know he had this range right there. Like, yo, he is killing this performance. I'm like, yo, you was on the bottom instead of in the goddamn press box.
But it's
listen. Let me tell y'all, it be people's whole dream to perform at the Laugh Factory in Hollywood. TEHRAN has his own night.
You are the man, TEHRAN. I've been to both of them.
But to TEHRAN's credit, everybody's counting.
But to TEHRAN's credit, he follows me on everything. So there's that part.
And on top of that, honestly, with two nights at the Laugh Factory that are my nights, I cultivate the space and I actually give opportunities in general to people who may not actually be able to get in the Laugh Factory because of the politics. Never mind the skill set, the politics. And when I was doing shows and sending people to Dubai every single week or sending them to Oman, London, Paris, shows that I was doing, and I would send other comedians, Ron G, BT Kingsley, I sent so many comedians whose first time out of the country doing comedy was on these shows because I love to give back, especially women of color. That's my number one jam because it's the most difficult for women of color to grow in comedy. They get the least amount of opportunities. Once again, life repeating itself. When it comes to the totem pole, it's like black people on the bottom, black women are on the lowest end. And so we have to help support them, carry them on our backs if we, no matter
Okay, so speaking of women, who is more delusional in how they see themselves, men or women?
Women. Women, by a long shot. For sure. It's not even close. Women. Yeah.
Like, I'm going to have to say men. I'm going to have to say men.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why are you saying women out, and why are you saying men?
TEHRAN is just like, TEHRAN
even it out.
No, I have to say men because that's my perspective, seeing what I've seen in the past. The reason why women act delusional, the way Austin and Ryan just said, is because of this. I'll tell you two reasons. First of all, Forever 21. And second of all, black men. Black men will holler at a girl at the end of the club. He will treat a 4 like a 10. And that's messing up the curve. We need to stop doing that. Well, just because alcohol. you want to catch the straggler, stop letting that go. I'm telling you, as a black man, as a Persian and black man, we need to stop doing that. Now, why I feel that men are delusional is because Rick Ross thinks he should be with a baddie. That to me is delusion. That to me, and it's so good and it works so much. But it's more than just money. Because I've seen Ronnie Ross with a baddie too, because Ronnie Ross is like, one day I'm gonna drop this mixtape. Trust me, girl. Let me borrow your car to go pick up another girl. Like, that's the truth. That is the truth. So I definitely think women might expect more, but men are delusional.
Okay. Nah, the men are more delusional about certain things, but women are delusional. But for what you said, women are more delusional because men lie to them so much that it's not even funny. It's not, and that's what makes them delusional though. Like, and I'm not at a point now where I'm not doing any more lying, and it's very tough. Huh?
You're anti-lie now?
Yeah,
not that you did before. No, I don't know. I'm asking.
No, I don't lie to them anymore. Okay. But I'm in my 30s and I talk to women in their 30s and man, it's very difficult to talk to somebody who's been lied to for 30 years. It's hard to tell them the truth because as far as they know, all those lies that they've been told over 30 years is true to them now. They've been living it. And it's very difficult. See, and like TEHRAN says, the 4 thinks she's hot now. See, men, when we're a 4, we know we're a 4 and we're so grateful. So grateful.
You're so grateful.
Whenever a woman decides to accept us. But a woman who's a 4 will look at you like, you're supposed to give me the world. Who's supposed to give you the world? You didn't even start out being given a good, you know what I mean, base to build from. Like, don't do this to me. Like, and don't get me wrong. And this is the thing. I'm not, even in my success, I don't want like the baddie, the whatever. I like regular. I'm from Concord, North Carolina. I like regular girls. I like girls. I like girls that look like women that I grew up with. Just a tad prettier. And that's it. Like, that's all I want to be compensated with by success. Just a tad prettier than where I come from. Mm-hmm. That's it. And trust me, that's not a fine woman. All right. That's a cute woman. All right.
Okay.
That's all I want is cute. But I get to this problem where like the scale is all jacked up everywhere. Okay. Like when you in LA, you can see a real 10. You in New York, you see a real 10, Miami, Houston. I see a girl I like, I'm probably in Des Moines, Iowa, or you know, Huntsville, Alabama. And I'm like, oh my God, this woman looks like the women in where I grew up, except she's just a tad prettier. This is what I'm looking for. Well, she's a 10 in her city. And I'm like, no. This is a good deal for us. This is good.
Ryan, did you just call the Des Moines 10 an LA 4?
Pretty much. Okay.
I just wanted to do the math. Here we are.
And she'll be like, you got to put in overtime to get me. I'm like, no, these other niggas should put in overtime to get you. We should have never met. I'm doing my job by talking to you. I'm doing my job by us connecting. You do know that, right? I'm holding up my end of the bargain.
Okay. Austin, you got to jump in. But let me ask y'all, who is making the 4.5s think they are 10s? Who is making the women think that?
black men, and I'll tell you who they do it the most.
It's black men for sure.
Fat white women, they do this the most to fat. Don't at me. I told you.
It's not a specific race. It's not a specific race.
Hispanic men are bad too.
Wants it bad enough to tell the lie. It ain't no black man. I've seen white dudes lie just as much as
anybody
else.
No, no, no. It's not about the lie.
Sure, sweetie, you're smart. You're funny. You're whatever it is. Like, nah, bruh. I'm pro lie. See, he anti lie.
I'm anti lie.
I'm lying for the rest of my life.
You believe in lies. Okay.
He's in a relationship. Austin's in a relationship. So Austin has to lie.
Once you get in a relationship, you must lie. That's man.
This is the thing though. Whenever it was a time where your woman knew you were lying because it made her feel good.
Mm-hmm.
And she respected that. That ain't what it is now. Like now.
Yeah. F you, now Beyonce. When you, she the now, one ruining lemonade.
Yeah, now you have to over lie to get the regular results of a regular lie. Like
over lie.
Instead of just saying you look good, you look good in this dress, you gotta be like, you the finest thing to ever walk through this place. And anything less than that, she's like, you don't like it. Oh my God. Okay. Okay.
Listen.
All right.
Men are the employees. Women are the employees. You gonna lie when you go into the interview and you're not ready for that job. No matter what. If I'm going in and he's like, or do you show up early every morning? Absolutely, sir. Never been late in my life. I promise you. I'll never go outside of this job and talk to another job. I promise you. Like, oh, well, you are definitely the man for the job. And you're That's like, true. Damn right I am. Now, let's interview him. And as soon as Burger King turns they back,
I'm
McDonald's like, so y'all hiring or what's up? What's good?
Hold on. That's your ambition is Burger King and McDonald's? Bruh. So listen.
No, the thing is, Teron.
Those are the fours.
Teron, that was the thing. He really is working with Burger King and McDonald's. The problem is they think they're Ruth Chris. And I'm like, no, they don't know. They don't sell hash browns at Roof Chris. They're like, you're not Roof Chris. And that's okay.
Because
I like hash browns. I'm coming here to get the hash browns. What's the problem?
Can we be very fair? I think the people that we're around with Ryan and Austin and myself, it's a different type of girl. So I'm at Ruth Chris and I'm like, yo, I don't want to pay this bill. Like this is, you could go to Outback Steakhouse and get pretty much the same meal if you asked me, right? Mm-hmm. So that's also a problem because when we're in LA, and Ryan made a great point, when you're in LA, a lot of women, they want to go out on dates to these very nice places. And it's like, hey, you're not going to go out of your geographical designation on me. If you live in Compton, we date in Compton. Like, I'm not taking you to Tulum. That's not what's happening for us, especially in the beginning. Like, you have to work your way up to Tulum. If you live in Inglewood, we eat in Inglewood. You understand? We getting Roscoe's. You're not getting boa. That's not a first date situation for you because that kind of stuff has a price tag. It has a price tag. Catch LA, you go to Catch, and you buy two drinks and an appetizer, that is $952,000. Do you understand me? That is $952,000 at that place. You could have bought, no, but realistically, it is like $500. You could have bought a house in Detroit for the money that you just spent on two drinks and an appetizer at Catch LA.
Easy. Okay. I'll tell you this. This is a perfect example. When I first moved out to LA, I started dating this girl. She got upset with me because I took her to Johnny Rocket 3 times in a row. And she was like, how could you even do that? I said, lady, you were just outside smoking a Black and Mild. If you think for 1 second I'm about to take you anywhere other than Johnny Rocket, you must be crazy. You get what you are. And at the end of the day you put that, I don't know, that big cigarette you smoking, it's like, yo, at the end of the day, I'm not overpaying for anything. You are who we thought you are. And so to me, I'm just like, look, man.
But not who you are, who we thought you are.
Okay, that goes into my next question, Austin. So a lot of times women say they didn't like a man when they first met him, but he grew on them. Do women grow on men, or it is what it is? You are who we thought you are.
Nah, you are who we thought you are. Now,
so women don't grow on men?
This is the exception and not the rule. If a girl stays around long enough, a dude might slip up, you know what I mean? Now y'all got a baby together and all of this other stuff. But for the most part, nah, dude is like, yo, you're the type of girl that I'm going to smash once and then I'm leaving. That's what he's doing. That's where you get all these girls now where it's like, I can't believe these dudes ain't what they said. You exactly the person that he thought you were, and he treated you accordingly. You just thought that you were somebody else, and it didn't matter.
Delusional.
Okay, here, Charmel, you're a wonderful person.
Thank you.
Men can grow on women because women can see beyond. They have an amazing capacity to see the inner person, which is why a young lady can date a man with one leg and be like, it's okay, baby, we can go to IHOP. That happens all the time.
Okay.
No pun intended.
Men can grow on women. Women grow off men. Like, okay. You can be, your best looking is when I see you first. If you grow from that, we get together. But when you fall from that, that's when you are one night, two night, three night, four, five night, six night, seven night whore, right? So that happens for real. And we've all seen it. And something that we were touching on is because of the way that as men and women, we value each other and how we perceive the world. Women are extremely audio, they're audio, and men are extremely visual. So women are audio and men are visual, which is why men lie and women wear makeup. Do you understand?
Right.
Women believe with their ears and men believe with their eyes. And that is part of the problem.
Okay, so men do lie, and sometimes women hear what they want to hear, correct?
Correct.
100%.
A lot of times. In fact, we've seen it happen the other way quite often. When you have a conversation with a young lady, Austin's in a relationship, he'll speak to this. When you have a conversation with a young lady, and then she says, so basically what you're saying, she's about to misinterpret everything you just
everything.
Said. She's waiting to just misinterpret. So we've seen it the other way. And we're familiar with it, but it also goes to the side of she's about to misinterpret the information you present and create a narrative of a relationship that does not exist within her mind, within the confines of justifying why she enjoyed your extremely toxic, intimate interaction.
Okay.
It's crazy. He on point with that. He on point with that. So basically what you're saying is, no, that's the opposite of what I'm saying, but... Since you want to take it that way, let's go ahead.
So you all mentioned dating, and I know Austin's in a relationship now. As you all become, or as men become more successful, do they look for different things in women? Like, does their standard or what their checklist, does that change for men?
Ryan?
yeah, in a sense.
Okay. Des Moines needs a job. Tell her.
Yeah. Now I don't really care what you do for a living, as long as you're really just doing something.
Okay.
Because I'm busy. I'm gonna be doing my thing. I'm gonna be paying all the bills. I'm gonna be doing my part. I just want you to want something for yourself. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. To have some sense of accomplishment, you know what I mean? All the money you make or whatever you do on your end, you'll be able to keep it, you'll buy and do whatever you want with it. But I don't want anybody who's going to like want me literally to pay for every single thing that they have or do or anything like that. Like my children ask that of me, you know what I mean? And I just want you to be more than that. But there was a time before I got to this point where what a woman did for a living probably would have made a difference. You know what I mean? I probably would have cared. I just don't anymore. I care more about it's very difficult to date in this industry, mm-hmm. Because we don't have a set schedule. Mm-hmm. Kind of, you know, if we land something, we land something. If we don't, we don't. We're on the road sometimes. Sometimes we're not. You know what I mean? I'm up first thing in the morning. Sometimes I sleep in. There's no telling, you know, what I'm going to be doing. But and I need somebody to be able to maneuver within that. Mm-hmm. And for some people, that's a tough task. That's a tough task. And also, like I said, I like regular girls. And, you know, I dealt with one recently, and self-sabotage. I don't know. She kept looking for, I don't know, kept looking for confirmation.
Confirmation of what? What is Austin laughing at? Because I know, I know y'all are best of friends. What is Austin laughing at?
She was looking. She was looking. She was searching for something.
That happens in relationships where at times, something Ryan touched on very well is our jobs are not jobs. A job is I check in at 9, I clock out at 5, and that is my day. We are not jobs. We have destinies, and destinies are extremely different. Right. It's 24/7, 365. And if you want to have an analogy of it being a job, we own the proverbial McDonald's that you don't realize that you are. We own the McDonald's, except we are the cashier, the manager, the janitor, the chef, the cook, the girl that gets your order wrong in the window. We're all of those and more. It's 24/7, 365, 366 on leap year. And it's not with rhyme and reason. It may not look like work to you, but trust me, we do work. And what looks like a party to you is a networking event, the same way that we were at the Visa Ray event. What may look like fun to you is actually something we've calculated and become a culmination of.
Oh my God.
Of action.
Nigga. Please let me. Oh my! Thank you, TEHRAN. Listen.
I'm helping you unpack. I'm helping you unpack.
I was working. It took me and the mother of my children years to see eye to eye on this. Whenever my career took off, I'm touring. I'm doing all this stuff. I'm at all these places. All she could see is this dude is having the time of his life. I'm like, no, this is my job. Like, I have to be here. I have to do this stuff. This is how bills are being paid. It just looks fun because people idolize, you know, the entertainment industry. People glorify it. So when you're living in it, people on the outside are like, man, this must be the greatest thing ever. And you're like, no, I really just want to go home, really. I would, if it was up to me, I wouldn't even be here. But I got to be here. I got to be here. I gotta network. I gotta make these appearances because the general public, who are the people who pay you, who make you hot, they want to see you in these places.
Right.
So if I'm not on the red carpet or at this party or doing whatever, they think I ain't doing nothing.
Right.
They literally think you're not doing anything. I remember seeing somebody post pictures of them on the red carpet. And I was like, I commented, I was like, you look gorgeous, you know, in a dress or whatever. And somebody commented, like a couple people commented under, Ryan, we can't wait until you're going to events like this. I was like, I was there. I just don't take pictures.
Like, no, you weren't. If they didn't see it.
Yeah. I was actually VIP. She was somebody's plus one. I was commenting because I was just showing love. I was like, y'all, I know how about the showing love, right?
Talk about how you were showing love. There was no agenda. You were literally just showing love. That's something
I was just showing love.
They said, too bad you weren't there.
Yeah, they were like, hilarious. Yeah, one day, Ryan, you're going to be there. One day.
I was there. But that's the thing.
I was there.
When we comment.
Jeff Brown.
What Jeff say?
Jeff said, we broker enjoyment. Do not hold the dopeness of what we do against us.
Exactly.
Yes. Charmel, what men are looking for is peace, sex, and purpose in that order.
Okay.
Peace and sex definitely more important than purpose. But if you want to do something at the end of the day, that's completely fine. But be my peace first, give me sex, and then figure out something to do. You do those three things as a woman, you will have a man.
Purpose. Yeah. Purpose is like, you know, have something that brings you some type of levity or joy or something. Even if it's doing puzzles, my nigga, do something. do something. Come home and be like, oh, this is what I've done. What about you? Waiting on you to get here. I don't think this is gonna work.
That's why I don't have pets. I don't want to open the door and the dog be too happy. What are you happy for? The purpose, however, some women's purpose tends to be, how do I ruin this relationship? And I tell
them, oh my God.
It is their purpose is how to ruin it. And it comes from insecurity. It comes from imposter syndrome. Now, remember, I am taking away if the man is at fault. There are many times where men are at fault. Men, when men are like, and when I say men, I actually just mean males, because there's a difference between males and men. Gender has no part to play in the mindset. Males tend to gaslight, manipulate women, and then when asked about them, go, oh, my ex was crazy. She was not crazy. You made her crazy. She was norm, perfectly sane, and better yet, she was right. That's different. No, but I'm talking about,
she was just woman crazy. She wasn't crazy. You made her crazy crazy.
You made her crazy.
She was just and lady men, crazy.
When you're a man and you actually are working on your destiny, just like Ryan said, sometimes some women have imposter syndrome. So in order to justify their feelings of insecurity, they outreach and push to sabotage this relationship. And they do so by nitpicking. They do so by nagging. And now I use that term specifically in this way. I don't mean women nag in general, but this, where were you? What were you doing when you perfectly know? That's nagging. Nitpicking is, oh, who's this picture that you liked? You mean my sister's? That's nitpicking.
Okay. And
that happens a lot. Ryan Davis left a comment that said, you look absolutely gorgeous. And a girl who wants to nitpick be like, why would you leave that comment? A person who understands would be like, you should leave more comments like that because it generates interest in your brand. Right, that is how this works. This is how we support one another. We leave each other LOLs and smiley faces on videos we've never watched of one another. We do that because it's a form of support. It helps the algorithm on social media, and it gives you a lot more presence. Right. That is why that charm is what we sell on stage. And a lot of people don't understand that. When we go on stage, when any performer goes on stage, you know why we remove the mic and move it to the back? Because we're removing the proverbial wall from us in the audience. We're giving you a piece of our soul. And that soul, just like when in Harry Potter, Voldemort broke his soul into 7 pieces, we're giving each audience member a piece of our soul, a piece of our soul. And so we're exhausted when it's done. And it may look like fun to you, but trust me, there's a lot of hours that you did not see that went into that. When Drake makes a song that's 3 minutes long, it did not take him 3 minutes to make that song. Right. It took a lifetime to get there. When you see a music video is 4 minutes, it wasn't as fun as you thought it was. It is to be perceived. That is what is Hollywood magic. That is how it works.
Yeah.
So we are just creating that magic. We're the magicians behind the scene. We're the Wizards of Oz. So when you remove that curtain, we're just Ryan Davis, Austin Hall, and TEHRAN von GHASRI.
Yeah, I just think, you know, based on what you are saying, that a lot of people just don't understand entertainment, the entertainment industry. They don't understand what it takes. Otherwise, they wouldn't say trivial things like, ooh, I want to work for you when they see you at an event. You have no training. I've never gone to a dentist like, ooh, I wish I worked here. You know what I mean? I don't know anything about being a dentist. So, but that's what they do. They trivialize what you do in the entertainment industry. You understand what I mean?
That happened recently to me, too. I said, I got to get me an assistant. They were like, so I can't be your assistant? You know nothing about this world. What are you? You know nothing about.
You know nothing.
Why would I hire you?
Right.
Yeah. But it's weird. If somebody you dating or want to be that, but like, learn. Because when you're an assistant out here, that's your job. Like, this motherfuckers who pay their bills.
It's a career.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with that. And I would be glad at getting somebody that this is what they do.
Right.
You doing it to be closer or to be nice or, you know, to feel like you're a part of what we're doing. Your intentions could be 100% pure and great and everything, but there is a skill level to being an assistant that, you know what I mean? That people don't get, you know, this is like you gotta, and being somebody's assistant, you're not gonna like them, by the way. That's right. Not how being somebody's assistant works. Right. Nobody who is an assistant likes the person that they are an assistant of.
At some point, they don't like
you. If we're in a relationship and we're dealing with each other, I don't want you to not like me. You know? Right. Yo, this just doesn't make any sense. They don't get it, though. It's hard. But this is a rare thing. You know, most people in the world are not in the entertainment industry. Right. So, you know, I think what's important for a lot of women to understand is you definitely need to date for potential. Mm-hmm. Because a man who's made it all the way to the point of success, he's not looking for you to add anything. Mm-hmm. He's not.
That relationship's transactional.
Yes.
Oh, he's going to keep it transactional in every 5 years or so, he's going to trade you in for a new version.
Yeah, Jeff Bezos not looking for a partner.
He traded his wife for a new one.
A made man don't care about your ideas to make his business grow. He doesn't.
I want to say it again.
A made man doesn't care about your ideas. To make his business grow. He doesn't care.
It's like Jordan's wife is like, well, why don't you take off from the 3-point line? What are you talking about?
Like, and Jordan traded in his wife for a new one too. And here's the thing. Here's the thing that comes out. In Farsi is one of the oldest languages we still use on Earth. It's over 5,000 years old. There's a lot of understanding of human nature within terms. The person that you're with, and when I say with, I mean your significant other. In Farsi, the word is yar. The reason why they use the word yar, a lot of people think it means lover. They think it means soulmate. It does not. It simply means teammate. So in fact, if Austin, Ryan, Charmel, and myself were on a basketball team where I would be excelling and I did not make Ryan's list, if we were on a basketball team, I would also call all of you my yar. It's the same word. It means teammate. Why would that be so important? Because when we are on the same team, when we are teammates, everyone plays their part. Everyone plays their position to their fullest potential and does not exceed that or undermine that and does not undermine each other. And we're both looking downfield, down court together. Right. And we all know what to do. That's why Andrew Bynum gets kicked out of the NBA when he shoots a 3-pointer. We don't need the center to shoot that 3-pointer. We need the center to be in the center. And so that's what happens in relationships when we're teammates and we're all having the same best interest, which is the us. So when it's you and I and we're fighting, it's not you versus me. It's you and I versus the problem. There's a difference.
Mm-hmm. There's a big difference. But look, that goes back to the piece.
Can I start this? I told y'all he was smart.
that boy is educated. That is an articulate man. But that goes back to peace. Mm-hmm. You will get traded in if your man comes home from working all day. The last thing he wants to hear from you. Mm-hmm. Is problems that you could have won, fixed yourself, or problems that you've created out of thin air for him to solve because you want to feel like he's doing something for you. That's not going to work. A dude with options ain't going to put up with that. He's going to be like, yo, I'm out of here. A dude with no options might just be like, fuck it, I'd rather go on my own.
Right. Exactly.
And by the way, we're only giving the male perspective because of the nature of this show. We are not saying that men are perfect and women are at fault.
Fuck up all the time. I mess up all the time.
That's right.
It's one of my favorite things to do. Yeah.
It's what we do.
If anybody watches this and think that I'm saying I'm perfect. No. This is about male perspective. The one of
he's saying he's perfect. Watch his videos. He is saying he is not. Consistent. No, in my bio, it says sapiosexual, toxic as SF. So you that's in my bio. Know it.
Believe it. I haven't figured out. I haven't figured out. And one day, I'll be lucky enough to find a woman who teaches me how to reassure my lady without it bugging me that that she's valuable in my life, right? The way to give that confirmation without being annoyed from keep on saying, because my thing is, if I didn't rock with you, I wouldn't be here. Me being here is a sure sign that I'm rocking with you. Mm-hmm. That has never worked, by the way. Never worked. Every woman that I've done that with,
not good enough.
Is like,
not good enough. It's never good enough. It's never good enough.
I need something else. So I'm working on that. You know, we all fall short of the glory. So
it's not enough. Ryan and Austin are best friends. Ryan does not need to continuously tell Austin that they are best friends. He does not call Austin and just be like, hey, just want to remind you, we're best friends. Doesn't need to do that. Mm-hmm. I talk to my mom once a month. That's all she needs, because she's my mom regardless. She knows that she's my mom. She's not like, is there another mom? She knows what it is. Whenever I talk to my mom, like realistically once a week, and she'll understand it. The concept is that reassurance process becomes, that in itself becomes indicative of a much larger problem.
Right.
You need to reassure, you need me to reassure you because you don't believe it, not because I don't believe it. So who is this actually for, and what is it actually about? And that's what we need to examine. A lot of things that we think of are problems are actually simply symptoms. They're symptoms of a much larger chasm that's existing. And so we have to figure out what that is in order to cure what the problem actually is, or what we will end up doing is removing symptom after symptom as they keep becoming continuous.
Like
and Austin said, if they had, Austin said they had purpose, they wouldn't be doing that.
They wouldn't. You know the concept, idle hands are the devil's playground, and idle mind is the same thing. When women have extreme free time, that's when they just start saying, oh, well, why didn't you say good morning? You just said morning. That's because you didn't have anything to do. And I said this, I actually had a situation where it was in the very beginnings of my career, but I was getting flown out for shows and I was trying to catch a flight. And I'm sure Ryan and Austin know how it is when you're trying to catch a flight and I'm always late and I get that energy, I'm running to it. And I was getting phone calls from a young lady who was like trying to fight. And I was like, you know what? I have to catch a flight right now. I don't care about anything you're saying to me, no matter what it is, because I have to catch a flight. And that's what my life is. I'm always, whether I'm at the airport or not, I always have to catch a flight. Do you understand? So I always have to be this person. I'm always in that mind state. So if you're not my piece.
Hey, bro, we be dating the same people, man.
They out here. They out here, bro. Niggas, boredom.
I got all kinds of negative energy because I was on the road and wasn't using my phone to their liking. That's happened in several situations. You don't text back fast. Mm-hmm. I'm on tour, my nigga. Like, I'm on the road. I'm doing shows. I'm doing radio. I'm doing television. I'm doing interviews. I'm taking naps. I'm making sure everybody got their stuff together. I'm making sure merchandise is ready to sell. I'm doing the count, making sure that nobody steals. Making sure all the money is right. Making sure the counts in the room is right. Mm-hmm. They you're think that you just show stage. Up there.
Exactly. You're getting prepared for being on stage. They think that. They think we just show up, get on stage, do an hour, and that's the end of it. That is not how it works. If that was the case, they wouldn't pay anyone $1 million. If something's easy, they will never pay you $1 million.
Right. I promise you, I do sometimes feel like I'm getting away with murder for what I get paid, but it is.
It's tough.
But they wouldn't pay me what they do if it was easy, Tehran. Thank you.
Wrong, Ryan. Wrong. You're not getting, because this is what you forget.
what I did it for free is, for a long time. This
exactly. It's you look at it as like it took an hour to do this. No, when it comes to art, when it comes to creativity, you're actually paying
took my life.
All of the hours. You're paying yes. for his lifetime.
Yes.
So while it looks to you like it's an hour, I promise you it's 5,000 hours, a combination of that, that yeah. is what you're seeing on stage. It's 10,000 hours of him right. putting time into this particular craft alone. It's all right. the most
yeah.
of sleeping in the car. It's all the girls that were like, you don't have enough to take me out. It's all of that. And this is what you're getting paid for.
And it's not a lot of, it's not a lot of things that are more annoying than when somebody doesn't take everything Teron just said into consideration. Remember, Ryan, when the tour just started, when I just started going on tour, and the girl that was messing in one of the cities right before I went on stage, she was trying to like, she was trying to talk to me, and she was like, what's going on? You acting weird. I'm like, yo, I'm about to go perform. Like, yo, you're just never mess with her ever again. She just couldn't right. understand. I'm like, yo, the fact that you can't appreciate what's going on right here, it just, it lets me know, yo, this is never going
to
happen.
Like, by the way, we didn't happen. Text each other before this to all be saying the same thing.
No, I get
right.
It's not a conspiracy because this is what girls think. At some point, we all just told each other, hey, Austin, say this, and then I'm going to show this to the girl. That's not what happened. I'll show interviews of other artists to girls all the time. Like, right. listen to what he's saying. Hold on. Mm-hmm. Believe him.
Right.
Yo.
Listen to Drake's song. Don't listen to the how it makes you dance. Listen
Yo,
to
the words thank
Drake
you.
Says in the song.
Drake listen to be telling song. The truth. Oh my God. So go much. Listen to this man's first two albums. I listen to it all the time. I had no idea how truthful and transparent this dude was being until I got into the life. I was like, oh, y'all don't even get the depth.
Drake got a song called I'm lyrics. Busy, bitch. I'm busy, oh, bitch. I'm busy. Listen to what I'm he busy. Said. Everybody, here's the thing. Every girl wants to date Drake until they date Drake, and then they hate Drake. Listen yeah. to what he's saying. Listen, all the same things that you liked about him that made you want to date him, now when you're with him, that's too much. Now you hate every one of those qualities. That's the problem.
No,
expectation is where women, you fail. Appreciation is where you succeed.
Women think they like men with options until they date men with options. Because options mean I don't have to take
none of it.
Psychological abuse anymore. I'm not doing this. Like, yo, I'm out. I'm cool. You, usually a dude will be like, yeah, I'll put up with it. She looks good. Nah. Ain't nobody put it. Drake is like, yo, get out. I'm about to make a song. But we just got to vibe it. You know, I'm vibing. I'm making a song. Move. Like, that's why he went to the studio and was like, I'm busy, bitch. I'm busy, bitch. Yeah.
That's literally, that's his next
that's
hit.
Good.
Bro, no lie. Like, I brought a girl to my show, right? And we were kicking it. Everything's great. My fans yelling like, encore, keep going, keep going. I'm like, nah, I got a girl in the back. Me and her have been kicking it for a while. You know, I owe her this time or whatever. They were like, oh, tell me why she pulled the curtain back to expose who she was to everybody.
Wrong move.
What?
I knew it was going to happen. I was just waiting.
Talk to her again. Ever. Ever.
Okay, I want y'all to clear one more thing up for me before I get to my last question. Okay, a lot of times men will say, I just want to be friends. Now, somehow that gets interpreted if they offer you vagina or they start doing stuff for you. They think you don't want to just be friends anymore. Can you clear that up?
Oh, yes. that's very simple. Yes. Men are a lot nicer to their friends than women are. women will friend zone you and not have sex with you. Men are so nice, we will be your friend and we'll still have sex with you because we're really good friends and sometimes we know you need it. How great are we, huh? How great are we?
It's that.
First of all, I'm trying to say a girl said that a bunch of guys are saying they want to be their friends.
But yeah, of course, like we don't want to date. Here, let me clarify what Ryan is referring to. Let's just be friends. from a guy is two things. Either A, you are unattractive to me.
Very unattractive. Not just unattractive.
Not just extremely very unattractive. I am unattractive. Now, that doesn't mean you're not attractive to somebody. Right. But
somebody.
If the person
I like
has Teron, eyes.
He will literally prevent anybody from getting canceled. This dude was a lawyer in a former life, dog. And I'm messing with him.
Did you go to Georgetown for something?
I did. Okay.
He's a lawyer in a current life. Yeah,
I have a master's in economics and a law degree. Yes.
Will be no cancel culture here.
So attractive and attraction are two different things. Attractive is a physical response to stimuli. You are attractive. It is a finite thing. Attraction is an illogical response to the stimuli. Mm-hmm. I am attracted to you, and that can happen in many folds. So you are either A, extremely unattractive to that person, or B, you are very difficult for that person, meaning I do not want a relationship with you, but I would love to be inside you at any given time because you're either crazy enough that it's amazing, not to downplay any mental incapabilities. It's crazy enough to be amazing in bed.
He is on top of it at every turn, ain't he?
Oh, of course.
Love the disclaimers. I love it.
He ain't missed yet, bruh.
It's the truth. Right. So you're either that or I just can't provide what it is that you want right now. I can't provide it. That happens a lot too. A lot of problems in relationships is that I, as a man, am not where I want to be in life. And therefore, I don't feel like it is apt for me to be in a relationship right now.
Okay.
Which happens. And we see that even with somebody who's successful, on the way to being successful, they're dating or married to one person, they become successful. That person knows the truth. We need to get rid of her. And then they get another person. If you don't believe me, ask Will Smith. If you don't believe me, ask Kevin Hart. If you don't believe me, ask Brad Pitt. If you don't believe me, ask George Clooney. It happens quite often.
Okay. Got it.
A lot.
Because now I've become this person.
Also with the affirmation.
Exactly. I need to be adored in this way. I need to be treated this way. If you're still treating me the old way, then I can't be with you. And that's a man's fault. That's not the woman's fault. That's the man's fault because we are different people on that path. However, when it comes to the friendship aspect, it does come down to either A, I just can't, or B, I just won't.
I can't do it.
And so I just want to be.
Or I won't be in a relationship. I can't do it.
I just want to be friends.
Yeah.
Is that the same as I don't want a relationship with you? Is that kind of explained the same way? Because that still causes confusion in people's minds. If something happens after you say any of that, they think your mind has changed.
Yeah. Nobody will lie to themselves like a woman who likes you.
Okay.
Say it again
so we can do t-shirts because my creative person's listening.
Nobody will lie to themselves like a woman who truly likes you.
Okay.
You can say everything you mean and you can act accordingly. But if she really likes you, she'll tell herself something completely different to give herself hope.
Right.
To give herself a reason to stick around or believe, no matter what you do. Even if you say, I don't want you to be in any part of my life whatsoever, and I'll completely distance myself from you, they'll find a way to still be around in some capacity, even if you don't want it. Because I don't know what that is. I don't know. I've seen some men do it too. You know what I mean? We've all heard of stalker type dudes.
Logic can't break emotion, bro.
Yeah.
You can't break emotion with logic. It just won't happen because the feelings are too much.
Well, that's the concept of emotion. Emotion is a thought devoid of logic, right? So it's an emotional response versus a logical thought.
I feel it. You're like, nah, he don't really mess with you like that. No, seriously, we have something. I promise you,
said,
you
no,
don't.
Seriously.
I promise you don't.
We've seen what Ryan has talked about in its extreme form. He hits me because he loves me. We've seen
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
It's extremely unfortunate. Mm-hmm. We've also seen it in the he will change. We've yes. seen that. He will change. Now, most people
that's
don't
the 217th change. Lady he's cheated on you with. No, trust
exactly.
me. It's 218.
He will change. We might grow, but we won't change. But growth, and the difference between the terms growth and change is something I can cause.
Mm-hmm.
Change is something I can cause. Growth is something you can cause, meaning change is something as a second person, you can change something, but growth only comes from within. People okay. don't change, they grow. So only I can cause my growth. Even if that growth comes from misfortune or a negative outcome or mm-hmm. a loss or a severe event in your life, a catalyst, it's still something that I've grown from on my own. Nothing can make me change, which is why sometimes it takes the most extremes to create the most mundane.
Okay, I get it.
No, you don't, but.
I do get it, I really
you
do.
Only do, Charmel, you only do because as of right now, you're more mature than, but in your 20s, it would have been almost impossible to get. And that's the cause of the conflict, mm-hmm. is that we see when women say things like nice guys, we want a nice guy. No, you don't. You ever been to a jail waiting room? Baddies. Listen, tens across the board. You know where there aren't tens? At the Geek Squad at Best Buy. I've never seen baddies at the
Comic-Con.
Never. Never. Unless they're playing cosplay and they would never date them. You understand?
Exactly.
Cosplay girl who's a nerd is still going home with us. You understand? That is how that works.
No, I totally get it. But I know that a lot of women would not get it. That's why I ask you to repeat it when you say things. This is my last question on every show. What is something you wish women knew or understood about men?
Well, look. I wish they knew. We are simple creatures. Stop trying to force the complex nature of yourself on us. It will not work. No matter how, like I tell my girl all the time, you are the worst person to have conversations with yourself. Because you're doing all of this. Right, without me, not asking one question, I'm not even in it. It's like they have their own scenes, mm-hmm. and then you walk in, and then they expect you to like be in it. And it's like, mm-hmm.
Why don't you know your lines, Austin?
Because I got it today. Because I'm bearded.
This is what Austin's referring to. You ever been at the green light and the car next to you takes off because they're racing and you had no idea
I'm not racing. I'm not racing.
And they even look at you too like, I won.
And I'm not even in a racing car. I'm in a Prius. Like, yo, what are you doing? What is this?
I was gonna simply say my concept that I wish more women understood is the concept of if you want it, you should earn it. And when I say that, I mean that, especially in the beginnings of the relationships, I am, as a person, I'm not in a relationship as Austin is. I am a person who's continually finding myself, growing. Here's how I feel. If you like Chanel, I like Anel. Do you understand? Like, I need you to compromise and work with me. Like,
this
you're not just
I don't know what just happened.
You're not just,
I like Anel.
Like, if you want this to be a transactional, we can have transactions. My concept is, but you have to earn it. My thing is earn it. Please earn it. Just earn it. I will earn you, but I need you to earn it. And it refers to loyalty, trust, vulnerability, all of these things that you want from the beginning. You have to earn it. Just earn it. That's all. Don't just want it, earn it.
I got good. Y'all. Anything
all right,
else?
So, Yeah, I agree with both of them, but this is the most important for me that goes outside of what, because I agree with them both, but when he talks to you seriously, mm-hmm. listen to what he's telling you, not what you're choosing to interpret. Mm-hmm. Listen to what he's telling you, because he's telling you. I've often had an issue where I'm literally telling somebody exactly what I want out of a partner. Mm-hmm. And yet they still want to do whatever they want to do or what they think you're going to like in your partner. Mm-hmm. Even though you've told them over and over and over again. So if you're treating me different than how I'm asking to be treated, no matter if what you think you're doing is good
or
it
better,
doesn't win you anything. It doesn't win right. you any points. Mm-hmm. Right. You know what will win you points? Treating me the way I'm asking you to treat me. That's how
it's not poetry. That's how you win. It's not poetry. This not poetry. Amanda Gorman. This,
I don't need above and beyond.
What do you say?
I don't need any extra. They want to do everything but what I ask of them to make me happy.
Right.
Right.
I don't need anything from you other than, like Austin said, peace, sex, and purpose.
Right.
Hey, don't get on my nerves. Don't do what Austin says and have whole arguments with yourself and then bring them to me as if I did some shit to you. Right. I wasn't even there for. Like, right. None of that shit. I ain't even, like, this is the thing. I'm getting older. Sex ain't even, like, high on my fucking list anymore. Like, I don't care. I'm cool on that. But sex is important because I need to be able to get it from you when I want it. You know what I mean? As rare as that is.
Consensually.
Nah, disclaimer. Yeah, because I don't need to be in a situation where, like, I don't ask for sex like that, but then when I do want it, you don't want to give it to me. I know I'm going to have sex. I'm trying to have sex with you. I'm trying to have sex.
You be a part of it.
Yeah, I really want you to be a part of my sexual experience is what I'm telling you when I say I want to have sex with you.
But he's not guilting you into doing something. It's just
don't use it as punishment or reward. By all means, do not do it.
Stop making
sex transactions. I'm still going to have sex. Yeah, I'm still going to have sex. I just wanted you to know I wanted it with you. I wanted it, you know, I brought it to you first. So
sex is not transactional. Emotion shouldn't be transactional. Love shouldn't be transactional.
It's like, man, when you deal with a man who knows what he wants, like seriously knows what he wants, right. You don't have to operate outside of that. You don't, and some women do this thing where they'll do all these things for you mm-hmm. in order for you to reciprocate because that's what she likes.
Right, right.
That doesn't have anything to do with me. You know what I mean?
Right.
So now you're doing shit for me I don't want, and you're wanting me to do it for you because you did it for me, not because you told me that's what you wanted. You could have just not did this for me and told me what you wanted, and we could have worked our way from that. It's the, like, what's with the, it's going way, like, all around the world just to make somebody happy who told you, Listen, you think I don't want to be happy? I'll give you the keys. I give you the password, everything. Hey, this is how you keep me. And it's just like everybody want to do their own thing.
That's the thing. The golden rule is do unto others as you want done unto yourself. The platinum rule is do unto others as they ask you for them to be done.
Right. Right. People don't want you. They want you how they want you. So when you tell somebody, yo, this is what it takes to keep me, they're like, nah, I think I'm gonna do it my way. Like, and then you just gotta be like, nah, this is no. I'm not about to.
And that's where you recognize you're not in love, you're in hope, and there's a difference.
And I'm not gonna be that man.
Is that the change component? where women look at men and say, I can do something with this, instead of accepting you where you are.
But that's actually within the nature, right? So we see this often. We see men who say things like, I don't like playing games. But what do men do every Sunday? They sit behind a TV screen and watch people play games. Men love playing games to a certain extent. The game has to have rules. You have to be able to win. You have to be able to lose. It can't just be a continuous loss. It can't be something. So we've seen this often where men will, if men are playing a video game and the game's too easy, they go, this game sucks. And if the game's too difficult, you know what they say? This game sucks. They're never going to blame themselves for not being able to be good at the game. Okay. This is my movie. I'm not cutting myself from my movie. So the game has to be just enough of a game for it to keep me intrigued, entertained, and be worthwhile to play. On the flip side, women say things like, I hate drama. But you know what? General Hospital's still on TV. You know why? Who watches soap operas? Women do. Women watch Grey's Anatomy. Women watch All My Children. Why? Because they like drama, but not so much drama that it's unsolvable, just enough drama to keep them entertained, engaged, and make it worthwhile to the next day. Which is why when I say nice guys finish last, nice guys have no drama. And therefore, there's nothing for a lot of women to change or fix or think they have to do.
Oh no, they'll create the drama though. They will.
Men
need how to could you do this to me? What I do? Drama. You know what you did.
They'll find it. It's like Cards Against Humanity. They'll find a card and pull it out and be like, you talk to your ex-girlfriend years ago?
Like, nah, I didn't.
Yeah, nah, man. They'll definitely create it. Don't underestimate your girl's imagination ever. Don't
ever.
Hey, look, making sacrifices is not settling. Just be prepared to do what is necessary to get what you say you really want. That's really what it is.
And if you want a relationship to work out, realize this. Do not think of it as a commitment. Commitments are chores. Chores are meant to be broken. It's a decision. And why I say it's a decision is because when we make choices, most times, oftentimes, we stand by that decision. So when you choose a man, please stand by your decision. And when I say stand by your decision, that means stop being in hope, start being in love, allow the expectations that fail to become appreciations that succeed. Let that happen for you.
Alaikum salam.
Okay.
Salam alaikum.
Before I close out this show, that's a robe, isn't it, TEHRAN?
Yeah.
I want you all to understand it's that robed level out. Of robe that drew me to him. And I was like, I got to go talk to this man.
I wear a robe. Listen, I'm in a robe on stage, off stage. I've been wearing robes since high school. You catch me in a club, guess what? I'm in a robe.
Everywhere.
And when he says, when Austin says everywhere, he doesn't just mean LA, New York, Chicago, Miami, everywhere. Vegas, Houston, Dallas, Seattle, Saudi Arabia, Mumbai, India, Dubai, Morocco, London, Paris. I'm in a robe and I'm out in these streets.
Yeah, I didn't want them to think I was thinking like Walmart terry cloth robe. I'm like, no, that's not who I walked up to.
It depends. Sometimes it's a Target robe. I just like comfortable because the world is my home. I will tell you something. My peace of mind means more to me than everyone else's comfort. Period. Yes.
That's a beautiful way to be.
And TEHRAN, can you say that again one more time? I need that to run again, man. That sounded very profound, sir.
It's very true. My peace of mind means more to me than everyone else's comfort. Mm. Period. City girls, period, too. Like the city girls, period.
Words to live by. So, as always, my closers are, what I took from this conversation was peace, sex, and purpose, And by purpose, they mean something to do with yourselves. And then men are simplistic, and they keep emphasizing this. This show is 63 different men, 22 episodes, and they keep telling you they are simplistic. And now I learned a concept, though, so ladies, you need to write this down. Overlie. I thought I'd heard it all in 25 years. Overlie. So sometimes the expectations are so high, and you're not listening. Now they got to overlie. So, and also, when you say basically, as you listen to a man, you are waiting to misinterpret what he said to you. So stop listening for the opportunity to misinterpret what he said to you. And nobody lies more to themselves than a woman who really likes a man. So I was listening.
No, Charmel, you were not listening. You were comprehending. There's a difference.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Jesus.
And so I gotta thank my special guests. We had so much fun at the beginning, but I love these guys sincerely, and they are really have hearts of gold, and they are amazing. Ryan Davis, Austin Hall, and TEHRAN GHASRI. And I want to thank my squad, my producer, Corey Marshall, who's watching, and creative director, Bilal Behar, Monica Malik, John DeGreat. And thank everyone who helps me behind the scenes. Thank you, guys. You aren't always good on the live, but y'all are amazing on the playback. So I appreciate the numbers. And season two is heating up. Last week, we had Cisco and D-Ray Davis and Rip Michaels. This week, we had these amazing men. Next week, we have Slink Johnson, the homie coming through. DC Urban with his meaningless motivations. He's crazy. And also Chase Anthony from Bigger on BET Plus. And so we're going to have a good time next week. And then later on in the month, I got some R&B legends coming through to talk about love, life, and relationships. And I appreciate all the views and comments, but please like, share, subscribe, and follow, because I need that too, not just the views and the comments. So I appreciate you all. And
yeah, Ryan Davis. Follow. Charmel, who you got coming through later? The R&B legends. Is it Jodeci? Tell me you got Jodeci.
I don't want to say. I've had my pre.
Is it Pretty Ricky? Pretty Ricky? One of them's in jail.
It's not spectacular. Is it I know that because he's always on Clubhouse.
Yes, he is. I'm going to text you as soon as I get confirmations. But I put the questions out to them, the queries out, and they've said pretty much yes. I'm waiting for the firm before
love
I say it publicly.
Love it. Brian McKnight, Tank, and Genuine about to be on the show.
Look, now you overpromising.
No, yeah. Right? Okay, and the last thing, you all watch my new show, Just One Thing, titled after my book, Just One Thing, forward by Mike Epps. And my book chronicles my life. Now I'm chronicling other people's lives, their life-changing moments, the things that push them closer to their purpose. And so please watch that show on Wednesdays, Fridays, Thursdays. I think I'm doing it out of order because sometimes we don't do it on those days, but Friday and Thursday, always at 8 o'clock. So check me out live on YouTube and Facebook. And this week is Thursday and Friday. We're doing
I thought
show
you were just
live.
Gonna say every day, the way you was on Wednesday, Friday, right. Thursday, Monday, Sunday, Tuesday. Saturday. Just
doing
saying.
A lot.
I'm stacking them because last week I did 5 shows. So I was trying to think what I'm doing this week. I couldn't remember. And so, but I will see you guys next Tuesday, March 9th, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard, 5 p.m. Pacific. I'm Charmel McMillan. It is what it is, how men think. Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Thank you, guys. Love you all. And I appreciate you all so much. Talk to you all soon.
Bye.
Bye-bye.